So, good morning from my side. It's great to see such a lot of our people here and some visitors, but it's really great. And it's a privilege to tell you a little bit about what we think about smart. Now, you know about today, we talk about smart cities and smart this and smart cars and whatever. So I said, at first I looked at it and said, okay, let's talk about a smart university. And when I started to search on the internet, I see people don't talk about universities as smart, but it's already smart. But in any case, what we did over the last few months is to work very hard on our strategy, and that has been approved. And it's very much built around changing the way that we are going to do things. Now, it's small steps maybe in the beginning, and that's why the emphasis is on going, not that we've done it already. Let me just tell you what was the vision that we set. We said that we need this university, CPUT, this is now kids bringing together, of course, the library and the currently the name of Chains Center for E-Learning, and we have also the two together. It seems there's a possible name in future. It's already been going through the structures now. But and then also CTS and all the there are many others, MIS and so forth. But what we are doing is that kids is to say that we want to lead this university in innovative, with a strong emphasis on innovative use of technology, information, and knowledge to become a smart university of technology. We are a university of technology, but we must be a smart university. And that has to do with the way that we do our research, that we do our teaching and learning, or learning and teaching, how we conduct our business at the university, and how we interact with the community. And we want it, of course, well-supported, facilitated, integrated, and enhanced. We can't work with the chaos of lots and lots of systems. So, you said a lot. So, the emphasis is on to be a smart university. So, what is a smart? Let me unpack the smart university. And in the strategy document, it is also unpacked, so I'm going to read briefly. It means that we use technologies to its fullest extent to enhance our learning and teaching, to create the right environment for our students, to create that experience that the student would say, I'm really supported at this university, and it made a difference to my life, and I think that is the main idea. The problem is that when I look at technology and how we use technology, and 2 years ago I mentioned this already at the first technology event that I attended, and I said the problem is that we tend to stick to old paradigms. When we talk about normal industrial age classroom, or that's even older than the industrial age, is coming from even if you look at Greek times and ancient Roman times, it was exactly the same. We have rebuilt that just in electronic form. We just automated some things. And that's my biggest problem, that we are struggling, and especially we as academics, we believe things must be done maybe in the same way, I don't know. But it's difficult for us. And the older you get, like in my case, it's more than you get away from the paradigms. But that is one of the major problems. That's why I've said that also in the past, that we have to think anew. We don't live in the industrial age anymore. We don't prepare people anymore just to work on a production line and doing one simple job. So we need to get away of this old way of, I just teach you a few basic things. We can't do it anymore. So we need to think how we organize CPUT, how we structure it. Our policies, our strategies, especially teaching and learning, or learning and teaching, our pedagogy we had, and that's why there's research that's been done on the pedagogy side, and our curricula need to change. And we will talk a lot about that, because there are some more changes coming. And the one thing that we will have to do is to see that students can use any tool or any device that they want to. I listened to the statistics yesterday only about Vodacom. Vodacom is now the biggest network operator in Africa. And I see they say there are 17 million smartphones in South Africa. Okay, still not fourth generation. So then the third generation, the third generation network, there's even more. So our students, and I think when last, when we did 2 years ago a survey, there was 57% of our students have spoken. So it is really changing. So whatever, I think the days that we are, and we don't have the money anymore, right? You know what happened last year, and of a very large budget that we have for replacing our computers in the labs. CTS got about, I think, what was it, not even 20% of it. So we can't replace the computers, and so we have to think of alternatives. I think labs in the future will become scarcer and scarcer, where we will give all the computers and everything. And that's why there's a strong focus in our strategy on bring your own device. And that means one thing in this university, which is not up to standard. So at the moment, there's a hard lot of work behind the scenes, upgrading of cabling, upgrading of the wireless system, because it's just not, if you try to log into guest, it kicks you off this morning, because there are too many people. I just visited in Canada, Ryerson University, 2 weeks ago. And if you look in a room like this, you will see at least three APs, access points. Just a way of, because it's so intensively used. You have got, in any case, two or three devices connected to it. They say by 2020, we will have 6.8 devices, each person connected to the. This is what is happening. So we need to change our environment, and that's happening at the background. It's already started, and it's busy. We upgraded all the rural campuses and so on. So that's part of it. But the thing is that it can be used, and the wonderful thing is we used to use clickers and so on. Now you can use all those technologies in class just by using the student smartphones. There's so much more that you can use, and not to talk about education services and all of those things. Quite a lot with bring your own device. There's a Blackboard app, but that Saki can tell you all about in his people later, but I just want to say to you, there is a possibility of that, and students can more and more use that, or they can use a web interface, whatever they want to do. But we can, they can write at the same time on discussion boards, they can put up questions for you as a lecturer, various things. Of course, they can also be busy on Facebook and so on, but we hope not. But there's a lot. The wonderful thing is that it changes the way that we interact with students. It changes the way that they study. It changes the way that the onus is only on me as a lecturer. And I have to transfer all the knowledge. It changes the responsibility to the students. And it is very important for their assimilation and structuring of new knowledge. And that's why we are going in that direction. And what you also need to know, it suddenly alters the access points of knowledge. As soon as we start with this model, it means I'm so afraid that I have to put anything online because my students won't attend my classes anymore. And that is a fallacy, because if you have something different that's not available in the textbook or online, then the students will anyways come. So what we need to do is think again anew. Do you really have to teach face-to-face everything, or can we go more and more online like the world is doing at the moment? But remember, it's real-time sharing, just-in-time searching, and it's that extensive use of social networks amongst our students. We can use that, not to talk about all the others. Okay. What you will see in the world, and this brings me to the next step in our strategy that is now beginning to unroll, and together with Prof. Stark, and in Stark we will, in the next few months, starting to drive this very strongly. Some of our neighbors are ahead of us, but after what happened last year, and we realized that increases will be very difficult in the future. I think you can all realize it. We are battling at the moment. To meet, make all ends meet. Most universities are battling. Some universities have to let staff go. There are various options that people are doing. We have to change our expensive model of education. I don't think we can keep on building buildings at millions and millions and millions. Neither can we have people staying on campus, coming from afar, staying on campus, expensive accommodation. So the world is going everywhere that I've seen. In Mexico that I visited, it's going massively online. If you live in Mexico City, it's almost difficult. It will take you 4 to 5 hours to get to the university because Mexico City has got 22 million people. So they've gone online, mostly. Monterrey University in Mexico. I visited them. And that's why there's an increase. There's really the enrollment, if you look at it, is growing. And it provides the same quality. The research told us it's the same quality. It's not necessarily better. There are benefits, and of course, there are also some downside to everything. Somebody once said to me, I never thought of anything or raising my children online. So, and it's true. So there are things, that's why a hybrid model quite often is there. But we can't. Our models are just not sustainable. So we have to think, and that's why you will see. I also had a meeting with the University of South Australia, and where every course that you design a course if you want it for either online, but it must be, if you have a course that's face-to-face, it must also be online. And it's presented worldwide, and that's how they generate their income for the university. And I think we are going in some sort of direction where we will have more and more courses presented online. We're working with a master's that they will run now only online, and that is it. So yeah, there's quality assurance things and many things that we still need to sort out. But we are going in that direction, and you will have to start thinking in that direction. That's why I'm emphasizing something that we know, like online learning. Blackboard, we decided, will be the central, really the central portal. I mean, it is so difficult if I need to use this tool and this tool and this tool and this tool. So what you do is, the wonderful thing about Blackboard, how we developed, is that you can integrate a variety of external tools into Blackboard. And the thing about that, it makes it easier for students, and that the team from the unit will help you with. But the other side of it is when you, whatever happens there can also be analyzed by the learning analytics, which is important for us. Because the emphasis also, because of the complaint that there's not a good throughput, and throughput eventually also affects the money we get in subsidies, of course. So that's why we will focus more and more on simplifying things. Not hundreds and hundreds of systems, but whatever you want to use, you use it in this portal, and it must be available. And that doesn't mean it stifles you in whatever you want to use. I think it's not the idea. And the unit will continue to do research about new technologies that can be used in it. What I also want to say is that we more and more want to use, there's various tools that you can use, from Skype to WebEx and Adobe and whatever. But we want to start more and more using Collaborate as an online tool for your interaction with students. Because again, it saves it automatically. On the other side, it is there for reference purpose. But on the other side, it also enables us with learning analytics. So what we need to think about the university is that people don't come to us anymore. Now we have to go to the people. That's the whole idea. So we have to redesign our systems and technology and learning spaces. The learning spaces is a bit difficult because we would like a major budget for that, and then we can create beautiful social spaces and wonderful things. And we have to do it in a small way, maybe, if we can find it. So the way forward for me is to expand immediately on the hybrid and the online classrooms, and to go internationally. Not just South Africa, we can. I think again, some of our neighboring universities are ahead of us, but we need to wake up. I think it is a more cost-effective, and it can bring revenue for the university, but I don't see it in the first instance as only revenue. I see it as an opportunity that we can change the life of people in Africa and even in the world, because I think what I've seen is that we have great content that some of you and others have put online, and we can.
changes.
So there are benefits. Of course, there are challenges. Be careful for the burnout of our lecturers. Now you can suddenly work 24 hours a day. So we have to. But we will have to prepare for change. What I mean is we need to start training our faculty on how to oversee an online classroom, how to work rather with tutors than doing it yourself, the online tutors. And we have to rethink our models. We need to start enhancing electronic course materials. We need to start thinking of virtual office hours that you have online where students can see you. And we need to change our marketing a little bit better than just hoping we are getting a few. Because now you are not limited to classroom size. We are not necessarily capped by the government about how many students you may have in a certain course. I think we also will have to think in future. If we think only English, I think we make a mistake because there's French in Africa and many other languages, even Swahili and so on. So we need to think about multilingual instructors so that we can extend. We have to think, gee, I've only started. We have to think about converting our textbooks, of course, to e-books. I think we need to get away from physical text. It's way too expensive for students and for ourselves. So, and we will expand the library contents. And soon to come, you know this, eh? Can you remember? It was at Star Trek. Maybe I'm Scottish. So soon we will be in the living room. Okay, smart also means virtual libraries, and I have to go very fast now. We're already busy. The library is way ahead. Our library, I must tell you, is amongst the leading libraries. I think they're up there. Our e-journals is 100%. We don't really go for print much more. We have, our e-books are growing. We don't, this year we buy much less print, more and more e-books. The e-books are, can be used, you can take it out, your student can take it home. You can, it's a wonderful thing, a way of doing it. So, more and more electronic. Also moving to a service-based computing environment. Next year, the present RF system is 10 years old, will be upgraded to Alma. It's a cloud-based system, very much service-oriented, where you will see there's a unified discovery service, full text of books and online visual retrieval of images, audio, and so forth. Sophisticated services. So you'll see a major change next year. Blackboard moved to the cloud, next year it's the library moving to the cloud to make it. So even if here the electricity goes down here, it still runs. So it's still there, as long as you've got a connection. Okay, and also integrated with our analytics systems that Saki is driving. So we will see. Physical spaces in the library, let me not talk too much about that since I've got 5 minutes. But you will see we have, it's more redesigned for learning and research. So smart also means that we need to use this technology in research. And there's a lot happening in the library side on data management. It's, on behalf of the country, big data, all of those things. And of course, e-research, we also, UCT is leading in e-research and how we can really use technology to make research possible for our research. So there's a lot there that we are doing in the background and systems being developed. This also means that we must be easy to connect to your information. It also means that we must start using analytics, big data and analytics. We have it. We need to know what is happening to our students. Not when it's too late, after the exam it's too late. So we need to know it faster. And that's why you will see analytics is the buzzword in business, in education, everywhere. And it's all about to be able to predict. And we talk about advanced analytics where multiple methods are used. And so forth. We go beyond data mining, beyond traditional business intelligence. I don't see you. So that's why we are driving one of our strong emphasis at the moment is with some others in learning analytics. And that means the collection and analysis of data regarding students, because I want to know within the 3 weeks if the student is not performing, so that you as a lecturer can make a change. And the analytics system that we just implemented or busy implementing, Saki, when will it be finalized?
2 months.
2 months. You will be able to get an overview of the university, of the faculty, of your department, of you and your students. So you can see exactly. It will tell you this week this student is not performing. Because it analyzes activities online, it analyzes what you read, will be integrated with the library, what the student is reading, visiting, taking, all of those things. So you can get an overview. And the whole idea is to step in time, using your tutors or whatever you may have in that regard. Okay, there are various types. I want to get to the last one, the decisive, so that we can start to make decisions based on this information. Okay, but we need to move it to the edge, and for that what I see is that eventually we must have real time, almost, or near real time, so that we can make do things a little bit faster. There's a lot that we can do. Also location, this for instance, I saw the one library that is using this location analytics with the students, because you can track with GPS, and I can exactly see where students spend their time. And in the library and how they move, so that we can redesign things and do things. Okay. So then remove barriers, make it easier for you. Would love that. Remove the barriers. We are trying. So modernize. That means we need to modernize our systems and so forth. Let me make a few conclusions since I have to stop. I think what is it about? Taking us on this journey of greatness. Now last year our journey of greatness took a little bit of a dip. We were all a little, when we saw the broken windows and things, we didn't think it was a greatness. But I think we are there. I think we can do it. We are busy with it. But remember, it's not a function of circumstance. It's a conscious choice. It's hard work. It's discipline. I want to tell you quickly the railroad story. I turned that around. thank you, Eunice. I will pay a coffee. The railroad story in America is one of the best stories. If you think about Union Pacific, the major railroad, why would you have a Union Pacific Airways on it? It's because in America, the railroad business thought they were in the business of rails. Of railways and not in the business of transportation. I'm so afraid that we may think in universities we are in the business of teaching instead of students. And I think we must be very, very, very careful that we don't get fixed to a certain model. So we need a mind shift. It's a picture from long ago. That's what we need. And not only we start to think the unthinkable, we may never dare the impossible, we may never be able to move the seemingly immovable. Somebody once said to me, university is like a graveyard. Try moving a graveyard, you don't get much help from inside. But it's not, it can be. Seemingly immovable, you can move it. And at that I say, thank you.
But I think what he was talking about is quite important in taking us forward in as far as using technology, teaching and learning is concerned. And it's a pity that we didn't give him more time so that we can engage with it. But I guess that you got the mission he has for the institution, and you leave this space thinking about how you are going to get smart in your teaching. With the help of the unit, we will assist you, we will work with you. We cannot make it work. You can actually, you are the ones to implement it, because you are the ones who do the teaching and learning in the classrooms. You have any questions for Professor Fourie? Questions? Yes, ma'am?
I have a concern with the technology in school. That is not a subject that I had. How is that going to reach the from school to university, the technology side? So in school, CAP is not a compulsory subject. Computer application technology is not a compulsory subject in school. But now the learner must go to university, now is all this technology overwhelming. So how are you going to reach that? How are you going to change that?
The major problem, the major thing is that you will see that the library, there are so many of them here, the library are offering digital literacy course. I have the name correct, eh?
Information literacy.
And we we've just discussed that at the various levels that we want to make that a compulsory for all students to bring everybody to up to speed. It's the use of technology for searching and all of that, and getting the right information. So, and of course, a certain skills. But it is a major issue. But the lucky thing is that the more we move to the mobile environment, the more the students know how to use it in any case.
Also, to add on that, can I give you some? There is the government Operation Pakisa, which is geared at fast tracking the use of technology in teaching and learning in schools. It's happening at the moment. Last year, they had a series of 1-month sessions where experts were invited to develop a strategy for integrating technology in teaching and learning in schools. So the government is taking that forward, and if it works, then we'll be getting students or learners who already know how to use technology and how they are experienced with their teachers using technology in teaching and learning. So I do know that is happening at the moment. Ken?
I get the impression that actually the problem is that the majority of the staff is overwhelmed or underwhelmed by the technology, and that there's probably a bigger problem than the students.
Maybe you should say what you mean by the underwhelmed.
I mean, there's sufficient kind of technology.
I don't think the students are, if you look at the latest figures just during last year, the unrest time, and Saki can give you the exact figures there, I watched that with him, there was absolute a spike, and in January this year, there was I don't think the students have a problem so much with the uptake, but I think it's more that us. Because I've come a long way with, as when I was still at Stellenbosch University, it was my job at the business school, and it was so difficult for people to change. Because, you see, when I walk into a class and I've got all the knowledge, and it's my subject area, I've been doing it for years, I can just walk in, I don't have to prepare, but if you do it online, you have to prepare carefully. So it does take effort, and it's something strange, and there's no use that I are trained and I don't use it immediately. So I think there is a resistance, and I've seen that even if we recently, when we started for reasons of not having enough staff to change from shared drives to even just to taking it onto Blackboard so that we have one portal area, then there's lots of resistance because I think it is difficult. I mean, you sleep on the same side of the bed, so why would you change? So technology is more with us as veterans. Now, there are some younger ones that find it easy, but if you become within 5 years of retirement, then you don't want to go new ways. But I think the students are more in. They are always hungry. I think it's us that need to.
Last question, Prof. Any other question? Yes.
If from the current, you know, it is nice, what you have, it is a good image. I can see myself in that environment where technology is everywhere. But if the current challenges, some of our students, when they go, they don't have access to the internet. And mostly they've got connection only on campus, sometimes. But with this challenge, shall we emphasize today on e-learning or computer-based learning?
Computer-based learning, I doubt the e-learning thing. What you're saying is a problem, and it's uniquely a problem because of the distribution of wealth and the problem that our students do have. There are major initiatives in the Cape Town area between the city of Cape Town, the Western Province, and some telecom, for instance, and others, to make all areas have Wi-Fi access. So you'll see this, they are major in the background. So that's why I believe over time it will in any case change. It's like Stellenbosch, for instance, made a deal with, they've got Wi-Fi anywhere in Stellenbosch for students available. They made a deal with the company and so on. So for us it's difficult because our students live in Kailicha and they live in on their way to Milnerton and everywhere. So it is much more difficult. At one stage I wanted to look at the geographic spread so that I can see. That is a major stumbling block. So we will have to think creatively to make a deal with one or other company, whether it's MTN or Cell C or whoever, but there must be one or other way. Computer-based, I doubt it if that is our future. It's just too expensive. It is
not the use for carrying in one short
term. We have to, no, short term, we're still keeping things going. But we can't expand now and expand labs and get new. No, we still keep it going. But that's definitely for the next year. But we can't, for instance, this year, our computers are now reaching 7 and 8 years of age. And usually you have to replace it at 4 or 5 years. But there's just no budget for it, so we can't replace it. And students are asking in the residences, for instance, and saying, we want at least computers. So I said, okay, nobody can have a laptop and a desktop. If you have it, you must give one. So that if you have a laptop, then we will rather get your own desktop and give it to put it in the residences so that students at least have something. We will have to run a, what you're saying is true, we will have to run a dual for the moment, a dual pathway, otherwise because our students don't have that access.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor. I do have guests for speakers.
Is it?
But
I work here.
I organize yours and bring it here.